Hello everyone, my name is Milton Vasconcelos. We will talk a little bit today about the theories of economic development within our course of development and sustainability. During our class, we will go through some of the main economists that wrote about theories of economic development. We will talk a little bit about David Ricardo, Joseph Schumpeter, Walt Rostow, the economist of CEPAL, an important group, and Albert Richmond too. Probably you may have seen some of it in some course of introduction to economics and for the students of UFABC. Probably after you choose what is your course after the Bachelor of Science and Humanities, most of the course like economics, public policies, territorial planning, and other also have an entire course about development. But here the idea is to give a small introduction to these theories, and it will be important for our course, especially because along the course we will see a lot of criticism regarding these conventional theories about development through the view of sustainability. That will be our focus in the rest of the course. I will start, before we enter into economics, there are some sociological theories of development, especially Max Weber and Norbert Elias. Max Weber, some of you may have seen in the course of social structure and dynamics, estrutura e dinâmica social, and Norbert Elias, just a few professors, including this course too. Oh, but the main idea about development for Max Weber is that along the course of history, our society has this trend of becoming more and more rationalized, especially in the way people act, in become like trying to become more efficient using time, using the available resources, is what Weber would call like instrumental reason, like how you can manage to reach your goals in the most efficient way. And it would increase along history. Norbert Elias, on the other side, he draws more in the idea of psychoanalysis and psychology, and he stresses this point of view that human being as an animal that we are, we have biological impulses, and for example, eat as much as we can, do sex as much as we can. But since we start to live in society and we start to redirect our impulse, our desires to something that would benefit the whole society and not just us as an individual in the short term. So instead of trying to follow always these basic impulses, we would try to control them and to start to act in a different way. And this different way, Norbert Elias called to be like a civilized moral, like what is good or what is bad becomes something that is shared among the group. And it's important to keep society united and make it the best for everyone. So we will start with the first economist, David Ricardo. He wrote on from the 17th to 18th, 19th century, like, and so you can understand that it was like many centuries ago, like society was a little bit different than today. But his main idea is that we could start about the investment. For example, someone has some money and think, I will make some undertaking and build a company, make some innovation, build something. And then when he starts to do this, he starts to hire people to help building this thing that he wants to keep managing this new undertaking, the new this new venture. And of course, he pays people, but the profit, there's always a profit for this person that makes the investment. And as the people start to invest and hire more people, David Ricardo thinks that economy would gradually reach a point that is called full employment economy. That is where everyone or almost everyone already has a job. And then it starts to become difficult to hire someone because always someone already has a job. The only way is to increase the salary. So I tell someone, okay, I will pay you a little bit more than you receive now, and then you come to work with me. And then the salaries start increasing. It's a problem for the investor because as salaries increases, the profit of the venture decreases. And another consequence of that is that if people are very poor and don't have so much money, usually they will not have so much food. There will be hunger in the society, and people will not have a very good quality of health and life, and then the population will not grow so much. But since people already start to have a lot of money, everyone is working, the salaries are good, everyone has food to feed their family. So the idea that David Ricardo proposed that the population will start growing more and more. With that, the food demand would increase because there will be more people to feed. And to meet this demand, the agriculture lands would need to expand. And usually you start agriculture in the land that are more fertile. And then, since we need to expand, you expand to land that are not so much fertile, but they are the only lands that are left. So we have to plant and make food with these lands too. But since these lands are produce less food because they are less fertile, then the food prices increase. You have like it's more difficult to make food. There is more demand of food, so the food prices increase. And then people start to demand, no, you need to increase my salary. Food is so expensive now. And then you see that the salary increases in both two times, here and here again. So the profit is decreasing. So profit is decreasing in this cycle. And then because there is less profit, it's more difficult to make more investment and to make the economy grow more. So if it just stopped like that, then it would reach a limit for economic growth. But David Ricardo, he thinks that there is something that can be done. That is innovations that increase productivity. Both the productivity of the venture that is doing this investment that we accompany, and also innovation in productivity of agriculture too. And with this increase in productivity, then it's possible to get more profit and keep the cycle of investment going on. And then the economy can grow more and more. But David Ricardo, he thinks that it cannot go on forever. There will be a moment that there could be an exhaustion of innovation possibilities. That, okay, nothing more can be done. We are in the limit of of productivity. Cannot do more than that. And when we reach this point, we would reach what he called stationary state. That is a moment that the economy cannot grow anymore. And it will go stable. It will not decrease, but it will keep stable all the way along the rest of history, something like that. Well, David Ricardo proposed this idea of stationary state, and it will become an important theme in economics. Many other economists will start to give their opinion about, are we going really to reach a stationary state or not? What would be this stationary state? How would be our life? Would it be good? Would Could it be bad? And it's a very important topic. And I chose to bring David Ricardo to start the talk because he was like one of the first economists. And he was also, you can see in his talk that it has development and it has also the natural resources that for lands, for food, for people, and then he started to bring up this idea about what is sustainable given the resources that we have. So it's a important way to start our talk today. Well, and then I will start asking you to reflect a little bit, like based on the history of the 19th, 20th, and 21st century, the one that we are now, and to what extent that David Ricardo's concerns and predictions remain valid today? What changed from his time to our time today? Is it really what is valid, what is not valid, what is partially valid? And I will not answer it for you. We will make a discussion about it, and you'll be able to share your opinion with the other colleagues, and we will. And the idea is to make a reflection. So if you even want to pause the video now and think a little bit by yourself before we go on with the class, it would be good to make some notes, because then you can use it later, okay? Well, then we go to the next economist, Joseph Schumpeter, German, and he is later than David Ricardo, from 1883 to 1915, so maybe at least like 70 years ago that he died, he passed away, and he thinks that the core, the main essence of capitalism, not how it manages the money, how people buy and sell, but is what he called creative destruction. That is this constant renovation of social structures, production, products, how capitalism tries to reinvent itself and how the capitalist society keeps changing a long time. This concept of creative destruction, it's based on Karl Marx, the Marxist theory, that Marx say that the capitalism destroys the previous structures to create a new structure. And the name creative destruction was first used by Werner Sombart, a sociologist, but it was conceptualized like in detail and put in a theory and popularized by Joseph Schumpeter. But he used in a slightly different way than Marx, because Marx thinks that this creative destruction would in the end destroy capitalism and start socialism and communism, because it would bring the roots of its own destruction. But for Schumpeter, this creative destruction could go on forever into capitalism and bring society to a kind of unlimited development. So Schumpeter, he starts with the classical economic circular model, but he expands it. So in this circular model, that maybe some of you have studied in Introduction to Economics, we have the firms and families. And so the families work in the firms and receive their salary, and also they buy with this money from the salary, they buy the products and receive the products for them to eat, to have their household and have what they want for their life. But the criticism that Schumpeter makes is that in this scheme, there is no development. Where is the development there? This is a kind of stable circle. So he say there is the role of the entrepreneur, like the kind of the businessman. Because then he has an idea of innovation, like, let's make something new. Then he convinces the capitalist, like the bank, to give him a loan to implement this idea. But this idea can be a failure or a success because it's new. No one knows if it will really work or not. If it's a success, then we have the real innovation in the economy, and there is an extra profit for the entrepreneur, and for sure for the bank too. And after this first entrepreneur start this innovation, and everyone said, "Oh, it's working!" So he started to be imitated by other entrepreneurs, and this new way of production diffused through society, and there is a generalization of the profit. Everyone is more efficient and making, getting more money in the way they are selling their stuff. And so there is an economic growth with that. And then it goes on, because after you have more profit here, then there is a new entrepreneur that has another idea, and then it goes on in another cycle of innovation. That's the main idea that Schumpeter brought. So let's start with in the circular economy, not with the growth yet, and not with economical development. And we start with this basic economic chart of supply and demand. So here we have supply and demand in the vertical axis, and we have supply as the yellow line and demand as the red line. And here we have the price in the vertical axis. The idea is that always that you have an imbalance in the economy. For example, we have the price here, a kind of price that would match like lower supply than demand, so there is more things being offered than supply, then there will be a change in the price. And usually the price will change until then the curves of supply and demand match each other, cross each other here. And then you would return to the balance of economy. Sometimes there may be a change in the consumer needs. For example, if there is a population growth. But this is not economic development for Schumpeter. Okay? It's just a change in the people's needs, not in the way we produce things. And then in this case, then will be a change in price too, to match. Okay? But let's think that now we have a change in the way we produce things. There is an innovation that make us produce more with less resources. Here. Then we have more things being offered, and then there will be an adjustment in the price. But this is the economic development. When you change this yellow line here of supply, you change and it goes up, and that's why the place where we cross supply and demand is higher than before in the initial history that we are talking now. Do you understand? Okay, so we can go forward. Well, there are many types of economic innovation for Schumpeter. For example, there could be a new product, or like a new characteristic in an existing product, but could also be like a new production method to produce more efficiently, a new market. For example, when you have the colonization history and the countries in Europe start to travel to new colonies and try to sell their products in these new places, could be a new source of raw materials for semi-manufactured goods, for example. We change from the wheels that work with wind and water to start to use oil, for example, or coal or other kinds of fossil fuels that increase the productivity in the Industrial Revolution. or can be also a new organization, a new way to manage people, or a new way that you have like a big industry that is more efficient than the small industries, or many more industries competing with each other that are more become more efficient than a big industry that was existing in the past. So everything that produces better and produce something new, okay? And it is very important the role of credit to stimulate innovation in capitalism. I will go back here, that it's this part here of the capitalist. If you don't have this bank to give the money to implement the idea, then the capitalism would grow very slowly. The idea of the banks are very important for Schumpeter. Well, let's go back here. So Schumpeter will talk a lot about what makes the entrepreneur a special kind of people in society. What makes them innovate? Because it's the whole definition of entrepreneur is the person that is producing innovation, not like the owner of the business. It's just the person that brings a new idea and try to implement it. So they have this social role based on initiative, leadership to make this thing new and bring people to cooperate with him to make this new idea. It's not a social class. Could be, for example, someone that's starting to build a new product in their garage. It could be a very poor person that tried to make something new and sell in his neighborhood, for example. And it usually only exercise in a certain period of the life of the person. For example, usually the person makes an innovation, starts his business, and after this innovation is established, the person becomes a manager. But for Schumpeter, he's not an entrepreneur anymore unless he keeps innovating the whole life, which is not usually what happens. Well, the entrepreneur, they need to convince the banks to invest in the innovation. If they cannot do it, they will never implement their idea. So they need to be good convincing people. That's one of their characteristics. But it's not easy, because they need to leave this comfort zone of established standards, or this thing that everyone is already used, that we know that it works. But he needs to go to the bank and say, look, I have a new idea. And then the bank says, but isn't it risky? Then there is a new kind of rationality. That's not the status quo rationality of things that we already know, but the entrepreneur will convince the bank first showing his intuition, like saying like, it's a good idea, but he also has to show some planning. Thinking something like, okay, I expect that the profit will be this amount higher with this new idea. I expect there will be some difficulties, but I will go around them in this way, in this other way, and show all this planning to show like how he will avoid the risk. Okay? And there is a rationality in this, planning for the future. Well, but there may be some reactions against this innovation. For example, sometimes something may be so new for a society that it may be even illegal. For example, in the Middle Ages, getting profit was illegal. People should not think about that. So, and other things too, for example, nowadays, there may be a political barrier, for example, like the government may not be willing to accept some kind of change because people think like, oh, it's against the people that maintain me in the power. It will change so much the society. And there may be like some moral social condemnation too. We can think, for example, someone can have a great idea of how to clone other people, make clones. And then there will be like bioethics barrier for that, saying, oh, but it's not moral, it's not ethical to clone humans. And that's a difficulty. Well, it may be that some groups may be triggered by some innovation, and it may make things more difficult to achieve cooperation in society because of that. One example, when they started to implement the electronic way to pay the bus, and then you don't need anymore the guy that keeps changing money inside the bus. Like before, it was always the driver and the other person that keeps changing money. Nowadays, you almost don't have the second person. And a lot of people use card to pay the bus, for example. And there may be also the resistance from the consumers too. For example, a new kind of food that people don't adapt to their taste. There is always some risk when you bring a new product. And it may take some time for people to get used to it too. Well, and what makes the mind of the entrepreneur different from other people? Schumpeter said that first they are non-hedonistics, like they like to work. And instead of using their free time to have fun, to buy some products for his leisure, the person works, and when they get profit, they invest the money in this new, in his undertaking, in his venture, in his business, and instead of just getting this money, use it to have fun or to buy something more for him. And because this person has an ambition, inner ambition for social mobility. So he wants to go from the social place that he is now and start to get more money and go upper in the social ladder. And also there is this pleasure for creation, ingenuity, effort, and the person likes it. It's something that makes the person like have willpower to go forward and feel happy with this kind of life. And well, using his theory, especially in his when Schumpeter was still young, in his first writings and books, he came with this idea of the cycles of development that you always that the history of capitalism could be told using this idea that you will have an innovation and then you have economic growth, that is this axis, and here is time. And then it will grow fast and then it will start to decrease because it would stagnate, like in the circular economy again. But then there will come another innovation and you have a new economic wave of economic growth. Some people call it like development waves. And the idea of Schumpeter in his writings is that a long history of capitalism, these waves would be each time stronger, you have them going higher, and they will be more frequent. You will see like they become shorter in time. And then it will go indefinitely high, something like that. Now, there are other economies that will have a slightly different focus. For example, Usher, he will say that, okay, there is this innovation history in capitalism, but it's not like one big innovation. Usually, you have a lot of small innovations that go little by little accumulating, but they are registered in the history books as a big one. Like it's not like one person discovered the vapor machine, for example. Suddenly, you have a lot of small steps that they keep like making it more and more efficient through time before you reach the maximum level of a technology. This is, I told you a little bit of the writings of the young Schumpeter. When he started to become older, he started to be a little bit to give a little bit of criticism about capitalism, some fear that he started to have, because he noted that in each period of prices, and we can go back here, for example, when you have this, it's going down a little bit when you reach the climax of the innovation. In this period, then you have this small period of prices, then the large companies start to acquire the smaller ones that get broke. And this was not good for Schumpeter. And the other thing that he started to see is that the innovation started to require more and more capital. And this large corporation would start to assume the role of both the capital provider and innovation. So that duo, like the couple, entrepreneur and bank, start to lose importance. And this large corporation, they would have the money to invest in themselves and to invest in the innovation. It will reduce the possibility of innovation with this corporatization, big companies in the market. For example, you may think nowadays that probably the new model of mobile phones will not happen in a small garage with a poor inventor. It will happen in a very big company that we invest a lot of money there. And as these corporations start to become bigger and monopolize the market, they also start to be bigger than the go national governments and start to manipulate the governments and to dominate the governments also, like invest, like give money to the elections. In the electoral period, to the person that they want to be in the government, they choose the government representatives that will help them. I'm just to stop a little bit. I put the link. You can go in the description of the video and of a small, a short documentary called "Who Killed the Electric Car?" Just to give some example and a little bit linked to the theme of sustainability that is important in our course. And it shows like how the large automotive corporations and full companies, they try to delay the maximum as possible in the last decades, the development of electric cars. So the idea of electric cars could be already very well implemented like many decades ago, but always that there was a company that proposed it. Then all the other companies based on petroleum cars, gas cars, diesel, they do something like to lobby the government to stop it or to block the implementation of places to recharge the batteries of the electric car, or they buy the small company that is selling the electric car and then they kind of shut down the project after they buy it. Nowadays, we are starting to have more electric cars, but it's still not the. Still, most of the cars are still in gas and petrol debt because there is still a big pressure to maintain things like that. So I invite you to watch the trailer or the full documentary. I'm putting both links here, and it gives you a good idea. So you can pause this video, go into this new link, and then come back to this class. I think. It's just to change a little bit, not see me talking, keep listening to me all the time, change a little bit, and then you come back. Okay? Well, maybe you finished already to watch the trailer or the full documentary, so let's go back. Well, Schumpeter, he had some idea about what should be the late capitalism. And he think that there is this problem of the large corporation, but there is a hope because since the companies want to be more efficient, you need to provide more education to people. So in capitalism, there would be a trend of increasing education, offer of education. And since people would start to have more education, Schumpeter thinks that people would start to understand more how the corporatist capitalism is bad for economics, for the economy, and bad for quality of life of people in general. So, and also with more education, people would start to wish less for material goods and would start to give more importance for cultural goods, not for material life. Well, then in the election, people would start to choose representatives that match these new values and are contrary to these values of the corporativism, of capitalism, of these big companies. And then, in the limit, Schumpeter thinks that our society would become very similar to the ideal of socialism, a little bit what he would call a welfare state, but without a revolution like the Marxists, the Communist Party were trying to advocate at that time. I think, like, through democracy and education, we would reach a society where everyone would have a good quality of life and less inequality, in social inequality, economic inequality too. That's his idea. Like, it was like he published this text in 1942, so more than 55 years ago. So I would invite you to think about it too. I take into account these trends indicated by Schumpeter in 1942 regarding the evolution of capitalism, education, the political changes. Do you think it's valid or it's viable nowadays? Did it really happen, or do you think it may happen in the future? What do you think? So you can pause the video again, take some notes about your opinion, like now that it's fresh in your memory, this idea of Schumpeter. And we will discuss it together as an activity and share our opinions with each other about it, okay? Great. So Schumpeter had a lot of repercussions in history. His theories were very famous. One of the main consequences of his theories was the creation of development banks, banks that are created by governments or by international organizations to invest in innovation. So we have the BID, Inter-American Bank of Development, and many national banks in Brazil. There is the BNDES, for example, and other banks too that invest in development, with this idea that the investment in development will help people to start new business, to start new technologies, to make production better, and it will bring to economic growth. So it's a good thing, a good policy for the government to do that. There were also some criticism for Schumpeter theories, mainly not that he was wrong, but he didn't give so much focus, for example, for labor exploitation and social inequalities as Karl Marx did. So he didn't talk so much about this. He was talking more about growth, like in general. He didn't talk so much about the role of government in the economy. He talked more about entrepreneur and banks. But John Keynes, that stuff, if criticized a little bit Schumpeter. He was thinking, like, could the state be an inductor of innovation? Could make a policy, some kind of policy to public policy to increase innovation in society, for example, and bring more economic growth? And also, there are some simplification in that Schumpeter, he knew that every model has some simplification. So for Schumpeter, for example, the offer would create its own demand. It's like you bring a new product and people will see, oh, a new product. Ah, so let's buy it. And then the demand would increase indefinitely. And he also had a simplified assumption about full employment. He didn't think so much about unemployment, how it affects economics. He knew that it was a simplification, but it was not his focus. Okay? Well, and the other criticism is that how to deal with underdeveloped countries that are not so much innovative. Like if you think about some economy like United States, Europe, and you see people developing new technologies all the time, then it may the theories of Schumpeter are matches very well. But if you think about a country where people are struggling to survive, to make just to plan their own food, and they don't have so much surplus or much labor specialization to innovate. So, what should be done in this country? What should be done, for example, to bring economic growth there? Then it's something that Schumpeter didn't work so much into it. Okay? Then you will need other theories that we will talk more along our class today. And so we go to Walt Rostow. Walt Rostow, he is a little bit younger than Schumpeter. He was born 1916 and passed away 2003. He was an economist that got a lot of positions in development banks and international organizations. And the context where he started to write his theory was the geopolitical context after the Second World War, where the banks was financing the devastated countries, the Marshall Plan. And he was willing to bring an economic theory that was a kind of discourse showing that the capitalism was better than socialism to develop. And he was focusing especially to make this discourse for the underdeveloped countries, the poorest countries. Because in that moment where you have like socialism, capitalism, then you have this third world that was of poor countries that didn't know like should we adopt socialism, should we align with capitalism? And then Walt Rostow, he was trying to convince them that okay, go to capitalism, okay? And bring this discourse that to be adopted but also by the leaders of the developed countries in a way that they could make this kind of policy to not let the poor countries become socialists. Okay? So it's an opposition to the Marxists. Well, and so he proposed a theory called modernization theory that had the kind of stages of development. First, we started with the underdeveloped country, then he received international loans and these loans go to the state, the government, and this government used this loan to help to make the economy grow through industrialization. And then after this industrialization period, it becomes a developed country. So that's the idea that Rostow was trying to show to the underdeveloped countries, like, okay, get this loan, use well by your state, and then you become a developed country. And so, underdevelopment was just a stage in this historical process of economic development. It was just that some countries were still a little below, like beforehand, in this march to development, and they just need to follow the same path of the developed countries that they would reach there at one day. So he proposed five stages of development. So we have here in this graph the development level increasing and the time. And the first stage is the traditional society. Then we have the giving some conditions to the takeoff, like flying of the airplane. Then you have the takeoff, the march to maturity, and the mass consumption age. So you see that are very strong words. He was trying to make a discourse, like a kind of discourse that the political leaders could buy and that could help to convince both the developed and the underdeveloped countries. So let's see each one of these stages. The traditional societies, they would have few financial resources, low technology, predominantly subsistence agriculture, like they produce just barely what they can eat, what they need to eat, and they don't have surpluses. Like they can, since they cannot sell to other people, they cannot accumulate capital to invest. So, because of that, the traditional society, they would not develop. They would stay always in the same level of development. So, well, then we have the preconditions to the takeoff. Is a kind of transitional state that it needs internal social change to give some new values. For example, understand that there are other countries that are growing. For example, someone brings these new ideas, and this new idea can be even by colonization. For example, with this idea that if the European countries didn't start new colonies, not in America, Africa, and Asia, they would keep forever in the same stage of development. And because of colonization, the European countries bring new technology, new values, new money to these colonies, and it starts to go out from the traditional stage and start to create new conditions for development. So with this new condition, you start to have more labor specialization, not only agriculture. You have more new modern technologies and change in social values, politics, more knowledge. And with this, the productivity will increase. You have this first venture, new companies, new business, and also the expansion both of internal commerce within the country and external commerce with other countries. Then you have the takeoff. The takeoff is the first thing of the takeoff is the social value. When people like acknowledge like we are underdeveloped, we want to develop. Let's go. And this new value will destroy the ties that keep them in the traditional way of life. And then people would migrate to rural labor to industrial sector, and there will be a new political system, institutional system, social system that will approach what you see in Europe, in United States nowadays. And then you will go to the marginal maturity that these people that are in the urban areas, in the cities, they will get more and more specialized in very deep, a diversity of jobs. The products will start to become even more diverse. You have a lot of kinds of products being produced and being bought too. And there will be the substitution of imported goods. Like the country will start to produce things that before he needed to import because he could not produce, he didn't have technology before. And finally, you reach the mass consumption age, where the income per capita is already in a very high level, and then you have a better income distribution. Not before, in the other stages, you still have a lot of socioeconomic inequality within the country, but in this last stage, things get better for everyone. And with that, since everyone is getting a good salary, everyone has money to buy more products. And this is where we reach the mass consumption. The consumer market, the domestic consumer market grows, and everyone is getting money and buying and having a good life. Well, what happened with the workforce allocation in each stage? So here we have the five stages, and we have here agriculture, industry, and services, primary, secondary, and tertiary sectors. In the beginning, you have almost everyone in agriculture. Then it starts to decline and people go to industry. And then in the last stage, it starts to migrate from industry to services in the cities. That's how most of the jobs would go along this stage of development. So in his books, Walter Rostow gave a lot of historical examples about how many countries transitioned through each one of these stages. I just showed here some examples about the date where United Kingdom, United States, and Japan reached each state, and he described how the characteristics of each period. And the underdeveloped countries, the poorest countries, he also gives some examples, but they show that some of them are just like in this stage they didn't reach all the stages yet, but they would get there. That's his discourse. Well, and to complete in the way that we discussed the other authors, I would like to invite you to think about this too. What could be the criticisms, limitations, and some kinds of reservations that we could have regarding the Rostow's modernization theory? So I will also bring this to discussion with you together, one week, to share your opinions with one another, to think about it too, like what kind of problem we could have with this theory, okay? And I will not tell you in advance, so you have to think about that first, okay? Let's make it together, okay? Well, then we go to CEPAL, and it's the Comissão Econômica para América Latina e Caribe, like the Economic Commission for Latin America and Caribbean countries. It's a group of economists created by the United Nations to think about the economic policies for Latin America. And they started to criticize Rostow theory a little bit because there was this problem, because after some decades following Rostow strategy, what happened that why the Latin American countries did not become developed? Why did they not reach the level of the developed countries in Europe and North America and Australia, Japan, and all? And they also pointed out that the development that happened in Latin America increased a lot the social inequalities inside these countries. Like, just a few people got richer, and most of people were still poor. And they started to argue that underdevelopment is not a stage for development, like Rostow used to say, but it was a result of unequal relationships between the central and the peripheral countries. They call this dependence theory, something that says, like, okay, if you don't, because of this balance of power, especially economic power between countries, it would keep some countries always dependent of other countries. And they start to think, okay, how can we break it and make the Latin American countries and Caribbean countries and other underdeveloped countries less dependent of the central countries? There are many economists in this commission, but a main one was Raul Prebisch. He was born in 1901 and passed away in 1986. And he started discussing about Ricardo laws of comparative advantages. This because David Ricardo also had this idea that trade should be liberated, like without so much taxes and protectionism of internal markets, because then the countries that can produce in the best productive way because they have like a better natural resources that match this kind of production, then they would produce it better, cheaper, and then each country would produce the product that they can produce better, and in the end the market would be better, you will have higher economic growth in the whole world. But Raul Prebisch, he's criticized a little bit because he said that this law of comparative advantage does not work when you have unique relationships of power between countries. So the central country would always benefit more than the peripheral countries. Let's see a scheme of that. You have the central countries, and following this discourse of Walt Russell, they would invest in the peripheral countries. But it's not just one way, because the peripheral countries would have to pay the debt later with interest rate. Okay. They will pay much more than what was invested. But with this investment, the peripheral countries will start producing goods that they will sell to the central countries. But usually, it will be more like agriculture, mineral resources that have very low added value. It doesn't give so much profit. And on the other hand, the central countries would sell products that have a lot of technology aggregated on it that the peripheral countries cannot produce yet. And they have very high added value. They bring a lot of profit. Well, you can see with this balance that the central countries will always have a positive balance of payment. They always get a lot of profit. But the peripheral countries, they have low profit, they have to pay a lot of debt in the end. And so they will have always a negative balance of payment. They will become more and more in debt with the central countries, and they will always be less developed than the central countries. Well, just to exemplify, here there is the graph of the Gini index. The Gini index shows the inequality. And when it approaches 100, here in this graph, 0 to 60, it could go to 100. The higher it is, more unequal it is. And I have here two lines. One, this orange line, is the cross-border inequality, that is like inequality between countries. For example, poor countries and rich countries. And this blue line is the inequality inside the country, that is like with people inside the same country. And we see that the inequality among countries increased a lot from 18th to the until 1950s, and the inequality inside the countries decreased. Why? What does it mean? It means that the richer countries became richer in comparison with the poorer countries that became comparatively poorer comparing to the richer countries. So you have like more inequality between the countries. And inside each country, in the rich country, everyone was becoming richer. So they become equal within the country, everyone richer. But in the poor country, everyone was mostly still poor. So you have the rich people in one country, the poor people in another country. That's how you interpret both lines at the same time. And we need to understand that how Raoul Prebisch, he was proposing his theory in the 1950s, when it was still in this line, and he was thinking, okay, this thing here will go forever and reach one time. Actually, after that, it stabilized a little bit in the last 60 years, but it's still a lot of inequality between countries, okay? And so that's still a problem. It didn't revert at all. Showing another graph, we see how the gross domestic product per capita, like the richness of each country, in the advanced economies, the developed countries, it increased in a much higher rate than in the developing and emerging economies. It increases too for them, but increase less. So you see, like, the richer becomes richer faster, develops faster than the other ones. So how could the developing ones one day achieve this line if the distance keeps increasing more and more? Here we have another graph. Like everyone in the world, how the richest 1% is increasing, this purple line here, and how the poorest 99%, the amount of money that they have in comparison with the richest one is decreasing, and around 2015, the poorest 99% would have less money than the richest 1%. So in this graph, you can see also that the 62 richest persons in the world in 2015, they started to have more money than half of the people in the world. So it's a lot of concentration of wealth in this billionaire, the richest person in the world. This other graph, we divided the population by group. So in blue, we have the amount of population, and each group, like we have the poorest ones here in transition to the richest ones here. So, and in the purple bar, we have the amount of wealth that they have. So 71% of the population receives less than $10,000 per year, and they have just 3% of the wealth. While you have 0.7% of people that receives more than $1 million per year, and they have almost half of the wealth of the world. So we see how there is this disparity, this inequality. That is a little bit what gives more support to this theory of the CEPAL, like the inequality is increasing and it's becoming absurd in capitalism along history. Well, Celso Furtado was an important Brazilian economist, part of CEPAL too, and he was younger than Raul Prebisch. Was born in 1920s and died in 2004. And well, he compared what happened in developed countries and underdeveloped countries, how the economy works different in each one of them. So in the developed countries, first you have the technological development, a little bit like we saw in the theory of Schumpeter. Then, because of this new innovation, they can accumulate more capital, they increase profit. And because people are getting more profit, they can buy more products. So it changes the demand profile too. And it goes on growing every time more, as we saw in the theory of Schumpeter. And Walt Rostow too. But in underdeveloped countries, first, you have a change in the demand profile because people look to the developed countries and say, oh, new products, I want it too. But it's expensive. So, in order to be able to buy this product, I will have to accumulate some capital, accumulate some money, and then get this money, invest in some business here in Brazil or in other underdeveloped country, to make more money enough in order to start being able to buy this new product. So you see that it's a little bit the inverse, and it makes the underdeveloped countries always like run behind the developed countries. Like the developed countries are creating the products, and the underdeveloped countries are willing to reach there. And it's in the inverse way. And well, and it also has some consequences in the economy. For example, in the developed countries, the profit is largely reinvested in production, but in the underdeveloped countries, the industrial elite, the owners of the business, they use most of the profit that they have to buy the superfluous goods imported from the developed countries. So it's like this. They want to reach there from here to here, huh? Well, and then they have less money because the money returns to the developed countries and they don't have money to reinvest in their business and to improve their own technology. That's why the developed country would grow faster than the underdeveloped country. And the elite would also usually control the state because they have money to in the electoral process to pay the electoral campaigns and elect the ones that they want. And these government leaders will do everything to keep the same structure of low development and of dependency towards the developed countries. So, Celso Furtado criticized it a lot and say like, okay, we need a kind of political leader that breaks this cycle. Well, so let's compare a little bit the modernization theory of Walt Russell with the dependence theory of CEPAL. Walt Russell, the problem for development for him is that the initial stage of traditional community society that does not develop. And for CEPAL, the development problem is the international exploitation of the developed country that exploit the underdeveloped countries and get the money for them. The for modernization theory, the development would help the traditional communities to reach the developed countries, but for the dependence theory, if it fo keeps following the same trend, the underdeveloped will always be underdeveloped through the historical process. And the elite also have different roles in each one of these theories. For Walt Russell, the elite would be very important to introduce these new values, technologies, knowledge into the traditional communities. But for the CEPAL, the elites would reinforce this structure of dependence and would keep like in the same. They would like to keep this inequality both between countries and within the same country. And well, for Walter also, the world could be divided between modern and traditional societies. And in the dependence theory, it's like the industrial center in the peripheral countries that were predominantly agriculture. Okay? Well, I will finish our class talking a little bit about Albert Hirschman. He's a more contemporary economist that also works a lot in international banks. He was born in 1915 and died in 2012. He's the youngest one of the one that we are talking now. And Albert Hirschman, he is criticized Walt Rostam that there is no a single development recipe. Every country has a different social context that will define a different path for development. But he thinks that development must be sequential. In this aspect, he agrees with Walt Rostam, because he thinks that the countries that try to apply a revolution and change like in 5 years from underdeveloped to developed countries, or to make a very strong political revolution, change everything, in the end they just created more instability and they didn't reach this. They just became disorganized. To develop, you have to go like part by part, gradually each step. And well, he agrees with the CEPAL that there are unequal relationships between center and periphery countries, but he still thinks that it's worth for the peripheral countries to get the loan from the central governments, because given the rules of the game that we have now, the options that we have now, the poor countries, they just have two options. Or they keep in the same way they are because they don't have money to invest, or they keep this loan, develop a little bit, and they know that they will give like most of the profit for the central cultures, they will get in debt too. But at least they grow a little bit, and the quality of life increased a little with that. It's not like the best in the world, but it's what's possible to do. So they try. It's the option that they have, the only option that they have, instead of not having any development at all. And I got this graph here from the same study that I showed before when we were discussing about Raul Prebisch, but here showing one thing that Richman stressed a lot, that there is something good about this development, capitalism. For example, we see in blue is the how is the global population in each income group, like poor, low income, middle income, upper income, high income. Blue is in 2001 and purple in 2011, like 10 years later. And we see that the percentage of poor people decreased a lot and then increased in a little bit in each other of the other groups. So we see that even if it's increasing the inequality, and he agrees with that, with Sepp Paul, but it's decreasing the number of people that are in a very miserable situation in the last decades, like people that will face hunger, that will be vulnerable to natural disasters, like that would have a very low expectation of life. They will die younger by disease, for example, because they don't have money to access it, to access health services. So there's something good in the development. Not everything, but there's some. And this is another graph that is the World Bank likes to show it a lot. And here we have like the percent of the population in each income group, and here is the income, like low income until high income. And we see that the color, like 2003 is his orange line, 2013 is the blue line, and the estimation to 2035 is this green line. So we see that the number of people that are extremely poor is decreasing this part of the graph and gradually increasing this other part here that has a slightly higher income. So it's a little bit a benefit of economic development in the world along the last decade. Well, regarding the strategies for the development, Albert Richman, he thinks that the best strategy is the balanced growth. It's the one that they use in the Marshall Plan in the European countries after the war, that you give a lot of loan and the government invests in many sectors of the economy at the same time, and the economy grows together as a whole, and it's the best for the country, so for development. But Albert Richman, he thinks that it's not possible for underdeveloped countries because, first, they don't have a lot of resources to invest, they have just a little bit, and also the government have very limited operational structure. So even if you offer a lot of loan for them, like a lot of investment, the government will not be able to manage all this money investing a lot of things at the same time efficiently. Okay? So Albert Richman thinks, okay, there is little money, the government has limited capacity to manage it. So it's better to get this small money that we have and invest in the most promising segment of the economy, the one that would give more profit for the country, and then try to count with this kind, expect this kind of economic chain effect. Like, for example, you invest in mining, then you will hire people to work in the mining companies, and these people will start to will have some extra money that will buy more products in the supermarket, will invest more in education and other services, and then the economy of the country will start to increase, like in other sectors too, afterward. It's not the best, but it's what's possible. Albert Richman, he thinks that economic development tends always to create social inequality, a kind of trend of capitalism. So every time some people innovate and then get more profit, and other people that stay behind, they don't have profit. And the state, the government, should be the one to responsible to manage this imbalance, to not create a strong social conflict that would make the society disrupt. So the government should have always two kinds of policy for Albert Richman: the development policies that will actually give economic growth, but unequal, and then the government should also have social policies, socialized development, like assistential policy, education for policy for all, and health policy for all, or income distribution policy, some things like that. To illustrate it, Albert Hirschman, he tells a story of that he called the tunnel metaphor. At first, you have everyone in the same level of development. And then suppose that the government gets a loan to make a tunnel that will help people to reach an advanced development level. But the problem is that this tunnel is very narrow and you can pass just one car at a time. So we will have a few cars that pass here and a lot of people that are still in the lowest development level. And they will get very angry because they see the other one very rich and they remain poor and like, why? And they will complain. And then the government will need to manage to bring some income or some development from this area to this one. So at least to decrease this cost, okay? And that's what this idea about development policy, but together coupled with social policy. And well, I would like to finish our class asking you to think about this. Like, do you think, based on all this that we discussed, that it would be possible for Brazil to reduce the inequality, like the difference that it has in relation to the socioeconomic value level of developed countries, while also reducing the internal socioeconomic inequality in Brazil? What could be done to achieve this goal? Like, so there, I would like to see your answer. Yes, no, what strategy should be done? And what could be done better? Is it already on the way to change something? Or it's not possible at all? Well, I would like to hear, and I would like you to share this opinion and discuss among yourselves, okay, about that. Thank you very much for this class, for listening. If you have any questions and comments, you can reach me and in my email or any other space that you have for communication in this course. And I wait for you the next moments of our course. Thank you. Bye-bye.